Okay, good evening, everyone. Welcome to tonight's Shia. If you're listening to this on the video, you're not looking, you may not know whose Shia it is, but if you have the background, you see it's CHAZAQ, because right behind me it says CHAZAQ about 100 times. And from past experiences with CHAZAQ, Baruch Hashem, you always have the background, and you know exactly who and what the presentation is, and who is behind it, figuratively and literally. The Shia tonight is Lezecha Nishmas Aaron ben Esther and Reuven ben Bela. And the Shia tonight, the heading, the title, I believe they gave it, is Continuing on the Way, or Going Forward on the Way, meaning not letting anything stop you or stumble you. And it's a particularly apropos for this time of the year, which we'll explain as we go along. The Shia starts, tonight's class starts, with two famous people in Jewish history. Both of them are kings of the Jewish people. One is the first king, Shaul HaMelech, King Saul. The second one is the second king, David HaMelech, King David. There's many aspects about Shaul HaMelech and David HaMelech that could be discussed, but one particular point the Talmud makes is that Shaul HaMelech had one particular incident in his life that was problematic, and it was so problematic that he just couldn't recover from it. And it actually was the cause of his eternally losing the kingdom for himself and his descendants, of being the king of the Jewish people, of Klal Yisrael, of Bnei Yisrael. And the same section of the Talmud says that King David, David HaMelech, actually had two gigantic problems, and the two gigantic problems were both of extreme nature, thank you, and in both cases they proved to be surmountable, that he was able to get out of them without any problem. Why was King Shaul stuck? Because of his one problem, while King David managed to extricate himself from two problems? That's what we're going to explore. First, the Talmud says a person doesn't know, a person can't realize sometimes what's behind things, that Shaul ba'achas v'le olsoloi, Shaul had one problem and he couldn't get out of it, David b'shnayim v'olsoloi, David had two problems and could get out of it. The Talmudic source of this is in two places, in case you want to look it up afterwards in the big books on the sides here, Yuma Chof Beis Amud Beis and Sanhedrin Kuf Zayin Amud Aleph. What was King Saul's problem? What did he do wrong? What caused him to lose his entire kingdom and for his future descendants the same? The Talmud says because of his war with the Amalekites. King Shaul, the first king of the Jewish people, was given the task to do the mitzvah of eradicating Amalek. Amalek is the most wicked nation, attacked the Jewish people totally without provocation when they left Egypt, trying to take advantage of a nation that had emerged from slavery and wasn't particularly probably adept at military things, and they came from nowhere, so to speak, and they attacked for no reason, and they tried to attack the most vulnerable of the Jewish people. And Hashem said, Milchama l'Hashem ba'Amalek, there's an eternal war against Amalek, and everything Amalek is, and everything Amalek stands for. And when King Saul became the king, his job was get rid of Amalek. He took together the Jewish army, he went, he fought, he was victorious. But, there's always the but he didn't do as instructed, and he left the king of Amalek, Agag, alive, which he wasn't supposed to. And he also liked all those herds of sheep and animals and things that the Amalekites had. And he decided, you know, it's a very valuable livestock. Why don't we just bring it back? And he had a false kind of compassion that he wasn't supposed to have. It actually cost us dearly, because by leaving Agag alive, Agag ended up actually continuing the royal line of Amalek, and down that line was the famous man Haman, whoever you want to call him, but he's the guy in the Megillah that was this close to destroying the Jewish people in the time of Mordechai and Esther. And that was all the little slip of Shaul HaMelech. When he came back from the war victoriously, Shmuel HaNavi went out to greet him. And he said to Shmuel HaNavi, you know, Baruch Hashem, Shamati Bekoil Hashem. I listened to the voice of Hashem. If you want to look this up, it's in the Navi, Shmuel Aleph, Perek Tesvav. It's actually the Haftarah for Shabbos Pashat Zachar. I did what I was supposed to. I took care of everything good. And the Shmuel says to him, yeah, well, what's going on? You see, Agag is standing right there. What do you mean? And all these sheep from Amalek. Okay, I brought that because it'll be good sacrifices. It'll be, you know, worthwhile. But Shmuel tells him, but you were supposed to eradicate them. And he, you know, he's hemming and hawing. He's justifying. He did what he was supposed to. He did what he's supposed to. Well, you know, finally, he says, all right. Shmuel pressed him. And he says, Chotasi, I sinned. I made an error. Chotasi is the lightest of all sins. There's chet, avera, avon, different levels. And chet is the lowest level. I made a little mistake, okay, I made a little mistake. And then he adds, ki yoreisi hes ha'om v'eshma b'kolam. The reason I made the mistake is because it's not my fault. I was afraid of my soldiers, my officers, the people I took with me, who wanted me to have, you know, easy going with King Agag and the sheep and the herds. So I listened to them. Parenthetically, that was not true. Because if you actually look at the verses before, it says, Vayachamol Shaul v'ha'om, in Pasuk Tes. Shaul and the people had this wrong compassion. Doesn't say the people and Shaul. He was the first one. But he tried actually to reverse it and say, it wasn't really my idea. It was the people's idea, and I was overwhelmed, and you know, they're the majority, and I listened to them. Means that even when he finally said, Chotasi, I sinned, it was, I sinned, but, not my fault. So, you know, it's really them. It's them. You know, it's not me. Shmuel says to him, you better see if you can collect unemployment, because you're out of a job. Hashem doesn't want you to be king of the Jewish people anymore. Basically, what's behind it is, not only you didn't follow what you were instructed to do, but if you are claiming that you followed your people, your soldiers, what they said, so you're hardly worthy of being a leader. You know, I sinned, but I wasn't my fault. I listened to what people said I should do. What are you? Are you the leader or are you the follower? If you're the king, you have to set the example. Not be swayed by what people tell you, even if it would have been true. And he lost his kingdom. Shaul HaMelech was a king, but his kingdom afterwards did not transfer to his children, and his time of being king was curtailed, and he had a very poor ending where he actually was killed in battle, or virtually killed in battle. He actually fell on his own sword when he was about to be defeated in battle. And that was Shaul HaMelech. I'd like to add just a small comment that nobody should go home after this class saying Shaul HaMelech was small-time minor league guy. He wasn't. He was major. The Talmud says that he was a head above everybody, not just physically, but even spiritually. The Talmud says that anybody who says anything bad of Shaul HaMelech is making a drastic mistake. The Talmud even brings an incident where a particular Talmudic rabbi made a little bit of a verbal jab at Shaul HaMelech, and that night angels of terror came to visit him, telling him, how dare you speak so of such an illustrious man, Shaul HaMelech. So he was a giant in all ways spiritually too. But he made a mistake. What was his mistake? So on the surface, it looks like his mistake was that he didn't eradicate Amalek. True. But he had a bigger mistake. His bigger mistake was not owning up to what he did wrong and trying to correct it. When Shmuel HaMelech said, and what's this going on here? What's this Agag doing here? What's the sheep here? At that point, he had his opportunity to say, oy vey. I did wrong. I lost it. I don't know what happened to me. I really did the mad thing. Please forgive me. I want to do tshuva. I want to fix things. I want to have... He had his chance. Shmuel asked him again, what's going on, what's going on? Finally, he finally says the word he's supposed to say. Chotosi, I did an aveira, I did a sin. He finally says it, very late in the game. And even then, it said with a string attached. But it wasn't my fault. See, I sinned, but really it wasn't me. It was the people with me, they pressured me. I had political pressure. I couldn't, you know. Shmuel HaNavi says, sorry, you know, you're not there. Could be we can even translate this into our regular everyday tefillah. In the brachot, in the brachos, in the morning we say, we ask Hashem, lo lidei chet, we shouldn't come to do a chet, a small sin. Ve'lo lidei avera ve'avon, and not to do a avera, a bigger sin. Ve'avon, and a very big sin. And then we say, V'lolidei nisayon. We shouldn't have any nisyonot. We shouldn't have any tests. We shouldn't have any opportunities to do sin. Isn't that the wrong order? First we say we shouldn't do a small sin, a medium sin, a big sin. After we talk about doing the big sin, we talk about we shouldn't have any nisyonot. We shouldn't have any tests that we fall into doing sin. Shouldn't we say that first? First say, Hashem, help us, we shouldn't have any temptation to do a sin. And if we have a temptation to do a sin, nisayon, we shouldn't do it. And if we do it, it should be only a small one, not a big one. And if we do a bigger one, it shouldn't be the worst one. What's the use of saying, lo lidei nisayon, after already we did chet aveira v'avon? Shaul HaMelech might be answering that. Chet aveira v'avon, sins, big ones, bigger ones, giant ones, they happen. Person's human. People make mistakes. The question is, what do I do after that? Do I own up to it? And do I ask somebody, how do I fix this? What should I do to go forward? Or do I just say, you know, it's not my fault. I didn't do it. It's, you know, don't blame me. It's a circumstance. Da, da, da. After the chet and aveir avon, then comes the nisayon. My nisayon is... Do I own up to the chet aveir avon? Do I own up to it? Do I say, yes, I did it, now I'm going to do tshuva? Or do I say, it's really not an aveira, it's really not a sin, even if it is, it's not my fault, I didn't do it. Shaul HaMelech lost everything by that. And that's exactly the opposite of David HaMelech, of King David. King David had two incidents. One incident was the famous incident with Uriah HaChiti. Uriah HaChiti was a soldier in King David's army. He was married to a woman named Bathsheba. And when he was out to the war, King David took Bathsheba. And later on, Uriah HaChiti was sent on the command of King David to the front lines because he failed to follow the king's instructions, and he was deemed a moreid b'malchus, insubordinate. Even in today's armies, if a soldier is insubordinate to the commanders, he can be court-martialed, tried for treason or whatever. And Uriah Hiti had instructions from King David, commander-in-chief, and he didn't follow them. And King David sent him to the front, the most dangerous part of the war, and he was killed. After he was killed, now there's no more problem. He's out of the way, so to speak. And King David has Bathsheba, his former wife. The Navi, the prophet, comes, Noson HaNavi, the prophet Noson, comes to King David and he says to King David, I have something to tell you. There's a case in the courts that we want you to decide. What's the case? The case is there was a man, a rich man, with a herd of animals. And there was another man, a poor man, with one little animal. And the rich man took away the poor man's one animal and put it in his own herd. What should we do? And King David was enraged. What a chutzpah! What a nerve! The man has rich, so many flocks of animals. This poor guy has the one animal. He's taking it away. King David says, such a person, I can't imagine such a bad midot. And King David gives him a severe sentence. Who is this? And the prophet Natan HaNavi says to King David, it's you, your majesty. It's an analogy. You have a harem of wives. He didn't have actually that many wives, King David, but he had a number of wives. And Uriah Hiti had one wife, and you took it away. What you said is the punishment should be yours. What could have King David said, and what did he actually say? First, what he could have said was, wait a minute. Uriah Hiti was insubordinate, was chay of misa, was required to be executed for military insubordination. Number two, I took away his wife. It's not his wife. Every soldier in King David's army gave their wives conditional divorces when they left, in order that in case they get killed in battle, the woman should have been divorced beforehand and not have a problem which we call aguna, a woman whose husband is missing in action in the war and she can't remarry because we don't know if her husband's still alive or not. So King David could have said, what do you mean? He was killed in the war. Retroactively, she's a divorced woman from before. When I took her for myself, she was not in. She wasn't forbidden at that time. And he later on was killed or died on the front for insubordination. Everything is kasher, kosher, 100%. He could have said that, and he might have even been technically exonerated. And technically, yeah, court dismisses the case. Yes, yes. But exactly beautiful it isn't. Yeah, he might not have been legally responsible, but it's not high standards by any means. But he could have said that and gotten away with it. He didn't. He didn't give any excuses. He says immediately, right away, Chotasi Lashem. And he adds, whatever punishment I need to get, I need to get. And if you want to see the punishments he was thinking about and suggestions he was saying to Noson HaNavi, it's actually written in Tehillim, in Psalms, chapter 51, Perek Nun Aleph, where King David talks to Noson HaNavi about this. And he even uses the expression, Techata'eni be'ezoi ve'etaher, whip me with a whip if you need to. Whatever you need to do, whip me. He wasn't saying it meaninglessly. He's saying, like, whatever you want me to do, whatever my punishment is, punish me. I'm guilty. I did it. He had a legal way out. He didn't even try. He didn't even mitigate it. He didn't say, well, you know what? It wasn't nice, but legally, you want to give me a small punishment? Okay, maybe. No. No ifs, no ands, no buts. Difference King David and King Shaul. The second incident with King David was when for some reason he also did the sin of counting the Jewish people, taking a census of the Jewish people. We have a general idea altogether that bracha, blessing, is where things are a little bit tsnius, with tsniut. Tsniut doesn't just mean your form of dress, if you have a dress that's tsniut, modest dress, but modest conduct. The bracha isn't something which isn't publicized to everybody. It's not a plus for a person to go around and tell everybody, you know, I'm so rich, I have such a beautiful family, I own 63 houses in Miami Beach, I have 14 cars, whatever it is, or they're brilliant, so even if it's all true, the bracha isn't something which is a little bit more modestly dealt with. On the full scale of Bnei Yisrael, the Jewish people, it's the same way. The bracha is, we don't count the Jewish people. However many Jewish people there are, Kein Yirbu, there should be more, fine and good. We don't count and say this, except if Hashem says to count. When Hashem says to count, like Hashem told Moshe in the Midbar, in the desert, to count the Jewish people, okay, then Hashem says the mitzvah is fine. Even then, they really didn't count the people. Everybody gave a half a shekel, and they counted the half shekels, so you count the shekels, you know from the shekels how many people there are. King David, for some reason, took a census of the Jewish people without Hashem's command, and as soon as he finished the census, like his brains came back. His senses came back. You know how to spell everything. And he said, what did I do here? Vayach lev David oso, achar kain sofer asom. His heart started pounding. He had palpitations, blood pressure. Oh, what did I do here? What did I do? And the knock on the door is immediate. God Hanovi, the prophet God, comes and says to King David, what did you do? What did you do? Why did you expose the Jewish people to the chas v'shalom, the satan, or the negative forces to say, look, how many Jews there are, too many more, chas v'shalom, whatever it is. And King David says, okay, what do I have to do? And God Hanavi says to him an interesting thing. He says, well, in order to have kapara, forgiveness, and to fix this, you have three choices. One choice, there should be 7 years of famine. What's the next choice? Next choice is, for 3 months, you will run away and you will be pursued by your enemies that they will attempt to kill you. What's the third choice? Third choice, shloshes yamim dever, 3 days of a deadly plague. And David answers God Hanavi and says, well, Nipla Vayom David El God, Nipna no biyad Hashem uviyad Adam Alepoila. One thing I know for sure. I will fall into the hands of Hashem for my punishment and not into the hands of humans. Hashem might punish me, but it'll be with a rachamim, with some mercy. A human. If the human has a mitzvah to punish me, I'm very worried about that. So the first thing is, the 3 months that my enemies will pursue me, that's off the table. That's not a choice. Because that's given over to a human. He's given over the mitzvah to try and kill me. Oh, I don't want that. Better to fall into one of the things that is Hashem doing the punishment, not a human. And therefore, he picked that there should be 3 days of the plague. And the commentaries ask, okay, we understand he didn't pick the 3 months because he said, I want to fall into a kapara, into a punishment to fix me that is dealt by Hashem, not with the human being. So that's why I want the 3 months. But the other two are both from Hashem, Sheva Yeshanim Ra'av, 7 years of hunger, of famine, or 3 days of dever, of a deadly plague for 72 hours. Both of those are from Hashem. So why is he specifically picking the dever, the plague, instead of the famine? And the Radak comments and says, because the famine, he felt, as a king, he has plenty of food. He has otzrot, he has storehouses of food. The plague, the famine, it won't be a burden on him. The burden will be on the poor people, on the regular people, on the middle class. And they'll suffer. That's fair. That's fair. I made the mistake of taking the census. I'm going to throw it in a place. We're picking something that everybody's going to suffer, and I will have the least suffering because I'm a king. I'm going to pick the 3 days of Dever, of this plague. Everybody's equal. Me too. Does it help me being the king of Israel? And if God wants to vest it out on me, that I should be the first victim of this plague, or the only victim of it, or whatever it is, so be it. I did the mess. I paid a price. King David and King Saul, doing something wrong, making a mistake, making an avera, is normal, is human. It's not recommended, but you know, it happens. Intentionally, accidentally, weakness, passion, difficulties, whatever. What happens after that? The question is, when I wake up and when I'm, you know, more calm, and when I reevaluate things and when I think about what's going on and I realize, you know, this wasn't in order, what do I do? Do I deflect it to somebody else? Do I push it away? Or do I own up and say, okay, whatever needs to do to make my soul back in order, to make my mind back in order, to make me spiritually chiropractic experience, whatever it is, I'm ready. King David, what could be higher than King David, how his reactions were? And that's why David Melech Yisrael Chai V'Kayam, King David is eternal, his descendants were the kings of Israel, his descendants were the Reish Galusas in the time of the Second Temple, his descendants were the Reish Galusas after the time of the Second Temple, all the way to the future Moshiach. What could be more than that? Guess what? I got somebody more than King David. How could that be? I'll show you. King David had a great-great-great-grandson. His name was Chizkiyahu. He was also a king. He was a direct descendant of King David, and he was one of the line of the Judean kings. After the 10 tribes split, the 10 tribes and the tribe of Judah, and the line of King David's descendants were the kings of Judah, one of those in the line from between King David and the destruction of the first temple, sort of in the middle, a little toward the top of the line, so to speak, was the famous Chizkiyahu HaMelech. Chizkiyahu HaMelech was a righteous king. The Talmud talks about him excessively. The Talmud says that he did all kinds of great things to the extent that he was a potential candidate right there and then to be the Moshiach and the eternal bliss of the Jewish people and the world. The Talmud, I shouldn't even say the Talmud, the Novi in Melachim, Divrei Hayomim in Kisuvim, and the Talmud and the Zohar all record the same incident that happened with Chizkiyahu HaMelech. The incident was that Chizkiyahu became deathly ill. And the prophet Yeshayahu, Isaiah, came to visit him. And Isaiah came into him, and he said to him, I came to visit the sick. And Chizkiyahu said, that's, you know, nice of you, you know, but what's going to be? So what's happening? Why am I sick? So the prophet Yeshayahu, Isaiah, tells him, you know why? You're sick and you're going to die from this sickness. It's terminal, It's fatal because you didn't get married. Now make no mistake, he didn't not get married because he couldn't find the shidduch, because there was a shidduch crisis. Or, you know, he was looking for a shidduch online and couldn't find, and nobody wanted to marry him. We're not talking about that. That's your excuse. Somebody's trying to get married and they can't find the shidduch, it doesn't go, okay. So, what should they do? There were plenty of people who would have been very happy to marry Chizkiyahu HaMelech. He intentionally didn't get married. Why didn't he intentionally get married? He intentionally didn't get married because he was, besides being a king, he was a prophet. And he saw in his prophecy that he's going to have a son who's going to become the king after him. And this son is going to revert to the worst idolatry and the worst decadence, and he's going to bring down the people tremendously, and he's going to start the ball rolling downhill, which will eventually lead to a destruction of the first temple. That's what he saw in his prophecy. And he was right, by the way. He had a son later named Menashe, who ruled for 55 years and set things in motion very downhill. And he decided, I'm not letting this happen. I'm not going to get married. I'll stay a bachelor. There'll be no Menashe. There'll be no King Menashe. And the debacle won't happen. And everything's going to be good. And here, Yeshayahu comes in and tells him, you're dying for a punishment that you didn't get married. And Chizkiyahu says to Yeshaya, what do you mean? I did it for a good reason. I did it not to have a Menashe. In fact, I'm ready to marry your daughter, Yeshaya. Maybe your merit and my merit together will prevent this from happening. And Yeshaya tells him, no, I told you, you're gone. Yiskadal v'yitkadash. You're out of here. And Chizkiyahu says, but I meant well. I meant well. I meant to prevent this from happening. And Yeshaya says to him, yeah, I know that. But you mixed into Hashem's business. Your business is to do the mitzvot. The mitzvah is peru revu. The mitzvah is to get married and have children. That's your mitzvah. You're trying to manipulate the world. You're trying to mix in what's God's business. You're supposed to do your thing. And Hashem takes care of the rest. And you didn't. So you're gone. And Chizkiyahu says, but I'll do tshuva. No, you can't. And then Chizkiyahu says to him the most famous things. You know what, Yeshaya? You can leave now. Because I'm not accepting what you say. Because I have a tradition from my great-great-great-grandfather, King David. Afilu cherev chado munachas al tzavorei shalodam al yimna atzmoy min horachamim. Even if a sharp sword is on the neck of the person 1 nanosecond away from chopping his head off, guillotine chas v'shalom, al yimna atzmoy min horachamim, a person shouldn't withhold himself from Hashem's mercy. You're telling me it's too late? It's no such thing as too late. Everything you told me, I agree. I made a mistake. I mixed in God's business. I should have gotten married. I did wrong. I meant well. I did wrong. But there has to be a way for me to extricate myself because my great-great-grandfather says, Al yimna atzmoy min harachamim. And he turned to the wall. Yeshayahu left. Chizkiyahu turned to the wall, stood by the wall, and he davened to Hashem. And Hashem listened to his prayers. And Hashem told Yeshayahu, go back to Chizkiyahu's palace and tell him I heard his prayers and he will be granted 15 more years of life. Let him get married, let him have his children, whatever it's going to be, he should do what he's supposed to. Yeshayahu came back to Chizkiyahu and told him this. Chizkiyahu said, Good. I'd like a sign from Hashem that my prayer was really accepted. And Yeshaya says, well, what would you like for a sign? I can make the sun go forward 10 degrees in the sky suddenly. I can make the sun go backward 10 degrees in the sky suddenly. In other words, we can make the clock move fast in advance. You'll see right away, 10 o'clock, it's 2 in the afternoon, boom, boom. Or I can make it the other way. It's 10 o'clock, it's back 6 in the morning. Which way would you like? What do you think he did? He picked backward. He said, going forward is natural. All you make it is a little quicker. Going backward, the day should go backward, that's amazing. And the day went backward 10 degrees as a sign that he has 15 more years. It's interesting that Chizkiyahu, in a way, was even more than King David. King David admitted, I did wrong, I made a mistake. Uriachiti was a mistake. Mrs. Uriachiti, Batsheva. The census was a mistake. It wasn't that he thought he's doing a mitzvah. He knew he's doing an Aveira. But at that time, he had a weak moment. He did something improper. Chizkiyahu really thought he's doing the right thing. Chizkiyahu thought he's doing the biggest mitzvah. He's Moser Nefesh for the Jewish people not to have a Menashe. Nevertheless, when Yeshaya said to him, you did a big sin? He said, okay, I didn't know. I'm ready to do tshuva even then. And Yeshaya says, you can't. No such thing as I can't. Hashem is open for me. More than King David even. There's another part to the story. When the clock went back, it went back across the globe. It was a world event. And in Bavel, the king of Bavel was in the middle of his nap. The king of Bavel is Brodach Balashon ben Baladon. Brodach Baladon ben Baladon. In the book of, that's how he's in Melachim. In Yeshaya, he's called Merodach Baladon ben Baladon. With a bays, with a bread, with a mem, whatever it is. That's his name, the Babylonian king at that time, Melech Bavel. He took his nap, his post-morning nap, and he woke up, and instead of it being in the afternoon, it was still the morning. What did he think? What's going on? How could I be back the morning? The only logical explanation in his mind is, it's the next day. I slept all afternoon, all evening, all night, all the way to the next morning. I'm sleeping, 19 hours or something, 20 hours. And as dictators of the yesteryear, maybe today too, thought, this is a coup. It's a rebellion. My servants are trying to make me die of hunger. They probably induced some sleep into me so that I should keep sleeping for hours and hours and hours. I haven't eaten for close to 24 hours. They're trying to kill me by hunger, by famine, by fasting me. And he's getting all excited. He's going to kill his servants. And they tell him, no, we didn't do anything. It's the same day. How could it be the same day? So they told him, well, you know what happened? The king of Judah, this Chizkiyahu, he prayed to God, and God granted him years, and in order to give a sign that his prayer was accepted, the clock went back 4 hours. And the Berodach Baladin ben Baladin was nishtoimim. He was impressed. He was astonished. Whoa! Wow! The Jewish God can do that? Chizkiyahu HaMelech must be some special person. And he instructed his secretaries to write a letter to Chizkiyahu HaMelech about how wondrous this is. And he sent these messengers to Jerusalem to meet this great man Chizkiyahu. And the message that was written as following. Ksivle, his secretaries wrote the following words. Shlomo lemalko Chizkiyah. Peace unto you, King Chizkiyah. Shlomo lekarto d'Yerushalayim. Peace unto the city of Jerusalem. Shalom lemalko le'eloko rabo. Peace unto the great God. And they sent the messengers on the way. The chief secretary, Nebuchadnezzar, later king of Babylon, but at that time king Babylonia, at that time king, chief secretary, wasn't there when they wrote that. He was away, coffee break, I don't know. When he came back, he asked them what's going on. They told him the whole story with Chizkiyahu, that they wrote the letter, they sent it out. He said, you have a copy? Yeah, sure, we have the file copy. Take out the file copy. Shlomo lemalka Chizkiyah, peace unto King Chizkiyah, peace unto the city of Jerusalem, peace on Shlom, peace to the great God of the great God. He says, that's what you wrote? His words are, Kirulei Eloko Rabba, you call their God the great God, umichtavinu lei the soif, and you write it third, last? You call it the great God, but you're writing it third? First you're writing, peace unto the great King Chizkiyah, peace unto the city of Yerushalayim, peace unto the great God. You calling him the great God, the Jewish God, and you're writing it third? You're supposed to write, peace unto the great God. Then you could talk about Chizkiyah and Jerusalem. You first start off with Chizkiyah and Jerusalem before God. And Nebuchadnezzar started taking steps toward chasing after and retrieving the messengers to bring back the letter, to edit it and send it in a more proper way. And the angel stopped him. Because the couple of steps that he took was enough zchus that he ended up destroying the Beis HaMikdash. If he would have taken more steps, who knows what would have happened. Not the end of the story. Plenty to learn from this part too. But not the end of the story. When the messengers came to Jerusalem, full of excitement, that they're going to come to the spiritual city of the great God of Israel that moved the sun back, a miracle that was across the globe. They came to Chizkiyahu, and it says that Chizkiyahu greeted them. He was very happy to have them. He brought them into his house. He showed them a tour of Jerusalem, his palaces, the treasuries of his palace, the gold and the silver, all the valuables, the psalmim, the everything. He showed the treasures of the temple to them, and they started looking. Ooh, look at this, look at this, the silver, the gold, the gold, the silver, expensive. Whoa. And they left. Wow, what a beautiful city, what a lustrous temple, what a lustrous palace, what wealth and riches and beauty and art, and they went back to Babylonia. Yeshaya Hanavi shows up to Chizkiyah, and he says to Chizkiyah, Chizkiyah, what did you do? They came here all excited about the great miracle that Hashem did. They wanted to hear about Hashem, monotheism, the true God of the world. They came here excited about a God who makes miracles. It was an opportunity to show them that their paganism and silliness and worship of nonsense is taka what it is, nonsense. They came here for that. And you, by the time you finished with them, they had forgotten all about that and were just so busy being excited about the beautiful vessels in the temple and the beautiful ornaments in your palace. And they went home, instead of with a spiritual experience, they went home with a Guggenheim Museum experience. Nothing against the Guggenheim Museum. Because of that, the future is that your descendants will become servants in the house of the king of Babylonia, and all the treasures of the temple and of your personal things and of Jerusalem that you showed them will all be carted off by the Babylonians when they destroy the temple. And you and your family, not you, after you, your descendants will all be there in Babel. Lo yivaser dova, nothing will remain here. If you want the exact quote, Yeshayahu perek lamites, Isaiah chapter 39, toward the end of the chapter. What's Chizkiah's reaction now? Based on everything we heard in the last couple of minutes, his reaction should be, whoa, time to daven. Time to, you know, like he did when Yeshaya told him that you didn't get married and you're going to die. What did he do? He davened. He prayed. Tfilot. And Hashem listened. It would be the time for Chizkiah to grab a hold of his prayer book, put on his talit, and pray like he never prayed before. That would we expect. But that's not what he said. After he heard this horrific prophecy from Yeshayahu, he says the following. This is Perek Yeshayahu, Perek Lamites, Posuk Ches, Isaiah chapter 39, verse 8. Vayomer Chizkiyahu el Yeshayahu. Chizkiyahu says to Yeshayahu after hearing this dire future. Toiv dvar Hashem asher dibarto. It's okay. It's good what you said. No problem. Vayomer, he added, he said, Ki yiyya sholem ve'emes biyomai. It's going to be everything peaceful and okay in my lifetime, right? It's not happening in my lifetime, right? It's happening later, right? Yeah? No problem. It's happening to my descendants. It's happening to the next generation or two. It's happening down the line. Okay, no problem. It's not in my time. Shocking. It's shocking. What's going on? How could this be? The commentators go to town on this. This is what's going on. The Malbim, famous rabbi of only 120, 130 years ago, he died in 1888 or 1889, says, it's not so bad, like you think. He didn't mean that. He meant to say the following. We have a rule that if God sends a prophecy through a prophecy of doom, of bad, of negative, it can be changed. And if God sends a prophecy for good, positive, it's for sure good, positive, it won't be changed. In other words, it's a win situation. A good prophecy, a good prediction that a bona fide prophet says in the name of Hashem is guaranteed. It's not going to be messed up. And if there's a bad prophecy, like this one, you can still mitigate it. You can still change it. You can still do tshuva. You can still fix your lives. You can still have a, you know, there's Yom Kippurs, there's fast days, there's ways, tzedakah, you know, ways to fix it. Chizkiyahu meant to say, it's not in my time, means it's still far off. Okay, we have time, we'll fix it. We have time, we'll do something. We have time, we'll take care of it. That's what the Malbim tries to say as an explanation of what Chizkiah might have meant. But on the surface, it doesn't look like that. On the surface, it looks like he's callous. It's going to happen in my time that that we're going to be dragged off to Babylonia as slaves and everything's going to be sacked, ruined, and the temple destroyed and the palaces. No? Okay, no problem. It looks like that's what he's saying. And the Radak, famous commentary Rav David Kimchi, way before the Malbim actually, says it in that way. He says it that it's astonishing what Chizkiyah said. And the words of, and he says it, and also the Marikra, another commentator says similarly. I quote the Marikra, the Hebrew, and I'll translate it. V'hoyo loy levakesh rachmim al Yisrael. Chizkiyahu should have prayed for mercy for the Jewish people, for the people of Israel. Shenigzer aleihem golus babel b'shviloi, that the exile of Babylonia was decreed because of him. He should have prayed. V'loy bikesh. And he didn't say anything. He didn't pray. Weird. The best prayer. The man who prayed and got 15 years of life. The son went back for him. He failed. Chizkiyo, potential melech, Moshiach. Unbelievable. So who's going to help us now? We're really stuck. The man who we already said had certain character traits that were even better than King David, his great-great-great-grandfather, and who literally bought life through prayer, here he didn't even open up his siddur. Nothing. Tillim. Nothing. What's going on? So there's a secret. This verse that I quoted, where he said, it's okay if it's not in my lifetime, is Yeshayahu chapter 39, verse 8. It is the last pasuk, the last verse in that chapter. What is the first verse in the next chapter? The chapters, by the way, are divided arbitrarily. It was a later thing dividing into chapters. What is the next pasuk? What is the next verse after this verse? Chapter 40, verse 1. It's a very famous, famous, famous pasuk verse that we are going to say in every synagogue in a couple of weeks. In the Haftorah. Nachamu, nachamu, ami, Omar Hashem. Be consoled, my nation, so says Hashem. That's the next verse. What does that verse have to do with this? Chizkiah says, it's in my time? No. Okay, no problem. End. Next verse. Be comforted, my nation, so says Hashem. What's the connection, these two verses? Says the Ma'ari Kra, when he failed, Chizkiyahu, God sees, even Chizkiyahu failed. Who's going to stand up for the Jewish people? Omar HaKadosh Baruch Hu, God himself says, Chizkiyah, my great king Chizkiyah, Shehoyu Eloi L'nachem Eschem, that should have consoled you and done for you, Ve'ena Menachem Es Yerushalayim, and he doesn't try to console Jerusalem, Ve'enai Mevakesh Rachemim Al Yisrael, and he doesn't open up his prayer book to ask for mercy on the Jewish people, Eloim Retoiv Shiyah Sholem Ve'emes B'yomai, but instead he says, it's okay if it be good in my days. Hineni, I myself, God, Menachem es Yerushalayim, I will console Jerusalem. In the end, I'll fix it. There's nobody to step in. There's not a single Jew in the world, not even the King Chizkiyahu. I'll do it myself. Hahu da'amre, therefore the next verse is God's sentence. Chizkiyahu didn't do it, didn't console you, didn't help you. You're not hopeless. Even if all the rabbis, chazanim, tzaddikim, mekubalim, and every Jew in the world somehow doesn't do the job, don't worry, Jewish people, don't worry, Klal Yisrael, Ahu da'amrei nachanu v'nachamu ami. I myself will do the nechama. We go into the 3 weeks. We go into the 9 days. We go into the season with the mourning of the temple, years and years, and another year, and another year, and another year. We have our own personal destructions, our own personal challenges, universal challenges, national challenges, Beis Hamikdash challenges, private challenges, emotional challenges, mental challenges, financial challenges, social challenges, challenges, challenges. Sometimes you get all those choices, you check all of the above, you know, everything. Who do we turn to? Who can we turn to? Nachamu, nachamu, ami, omar Hashem. Hashem says nachamu. Summarization. We do something wrong, we own up to it. We try to fix it. We meant right, we find out it's wrong, we step forward and say, okay, what do we have to do to fix it? We don't shift the blame to somebody else, we go further. We don't give up hope. Chizkiyahu was told you're going to die. He didn't give up hope. And by the way, he had every reason to give up hope. Because the Zohar says that from the time of Yaakov Avinu till the time of Chizkiyahu, anybody who got sick died. And that's right. That's what the Zohar says. And Chizkiyahu was the first one where there was a recovery from an illness. So it certainly was unprecedented, and when he said you're going to die, it was sort of the precedent was there for it. You never give up hope. Al yimna atzmo min horachamim. Don't withhold yourself from Hashem's mercy. In fact, it's interesting. It almost seems that the state of a default of a Jew is to have the mercy. Because the statement that King David said, that Chizkiyahu quoted, was, even if a sword is on your neck, al yimna atzmo min horachamim. Don't withhold yourself from the mercy. It doesn't say, don't stop trying to get mercy, like you don't have it and you have to get it. It says, al yimna, don't withdraw your hand from the mercy. Meaning Hashem's rachamim and mercy is the natural state. Don't be a fool to disconnect yourself just because it looks like it's bad news. Don't be a fool to think you can't go forward because you don't see the way it's going to work. Because it's going to work anyway. And finally, who do we rely on in the end? Avinu Shebashamayim, Hashem. We rely on Hashem. Nothing here that I said, to the best of my ability, is fancy speeches, homiletics, or I'm making up some kind of story. This and everything that I said here is all written, basically, in the Navi, in the Kesuvim, in the Talmud, in the Zohar. Bona fide, real, not maybe ideas. It is it, the real thing. Hashem should all help us. We should be zocha, we should merit to feel it, to integrate it, to know it, to experience it, and to be happy. Amen, amen, amen.